Gentlemen, it's good to have you here at Chestnut Community Church, right in the heart of McKinney, Texas. We're glad to have all of you here. And for those of you on the iCampus watching us on internet, thank you for joining with us. We're glad to have all of you, those in here in person and those of you on the internet. We've got a beautiful first day of spring. Does it feel like it? Feels like Christmas was yesterday, and we're just moving right along. Hopefully we're in spring. My nose is telling me that it is because it gets clogged like crazy. But we're just glad to be able to come together and worship the Lord, and thank you for joining us today. We want to continue to pray for the folks in the Ukraine. And I keep saying the Ukraine. They like it to be called just Ukraine. But as I was reading Christianity Today online, something stuck at me. It was a quote by a pastor of a Russian Bible church in Moscow. I can't pronounce his name. I'm not going to try. Well, I am. Yevgeny Bakhmutsky. That sounds about right, doesn't it? Here's what he said. My soul is grieved. My heart is torn with horror and shame. My mind is shocked by human insanity. We are not politicians. We are children of God. We're not called to remake the geopolitical map of the world to please this or that ruler. Let the world see that the children of God love and accept one another, not because of language or nationality, but because they have been accepted by Christ. Boy, that guy is on top of it. There are 8 seminaries in Ukraine. All 8 have had people stay in their building while they were blowing it up all the way around them. And they were giving aid to the refugees who were leaving, making sure each one of them had a Bible, making sure each one had food and something to eat, somewhere to sleep, and then they would usher them on their way. The bravery, the stories that are coming out of Russia and Ukraine are glorifying God, and we want to pray for those believers. We want to pray for those men and women who are standing up to this invasion, unprovoked, and pray very, very hard that Mr. Putin, President Putin, will come to his senses and back off instead of pushing buttons that nobody wants pushed. He's very close. So pray for them. We're going to pray for them here in just a minute. Beautiful flowers up here. Becky, thank you. I just love the blue and the gold. That's the colors of Ukraine. That's their flag color. And those are just absolutely gorgeous. Thank you. All right, let's just move on. Give us plenty of time to study the Word of God in 2 Peter chapter 2. And then next week, we'll be back in 1 John and just moving right along, getting out of March and headed into April. Why is April a good month? Well, it's tax month. Yeah, we got several birthdays on tax day. My birthday is before tax day, so that's a good thing. Anyway, join me as we pray. Father, let the Spirit of God reach down now and touch those brave men and women in Ukraine, those who are in the seminaries who are staying their post, those who are maintaining the gospel, recognizing that only the power of God can prevail. And Lord, we pray for President Putin that somehow your Spirit would soften his heart, that some way, somebody in his cabinet would say to him, Mr. President, let's stop this madness. And Lord, may we all, believers in Christ, lift up these, our brothers in other countries. But it's not just Russia and Ukraine. It's North Korea, China, parts of Africa, other places where believers are severely persecuted. Lord, it makes us long for the day when we can pray, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Now be with Victor as he preaches today. Be with Matthew as he leads our music. And let our hearts be lifted up in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Let's all stand. Let's praise the Lord this morning. Let's sing. Sweet by and by.
Trials darken every hand, and we cannot understand all the ways that God will lead us to that blessed promised land. But He'll guide us with His eye, and we'll follow till we die. We will understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God be gathered home, we will tell the story how we overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Oft our cherished plans have failed, disappointments have prevailed, and we wandered in the darkness, heavy-hearted and alone. But we're trusting in the Lord, and according to His word, we will understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God we gather home, we will tell the story how we overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Temptations, hidden snares often take us unaware, and our hearts are made to bleed for some thoughtless word or deed. And we wonder why the test, when we try to do our best, we will understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God we gathered home, we will tell the story how we overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them from pity, from sin and the grave. Weep for the erring one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Though they are sorrowing, still He awaiting, waiting the painful trial to receive. Plead with them earnestly, plead with them guilty, He will forgive with the guilt to relieve. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Down in the human heart, crushed by the tempter, feeling the burden that grace cannot see, touching the loving heart, taken by kindness, cords that were broken will vibrate once more. And rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus Jesus will save.
On the last.
Rescue the perishing, duty demands it. Strength for thy labor, the Lord will provide. Back the narrow way, patiently wend it. Tell the poor wanderer the Savior has died. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all thy works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, and how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and sweetly in the trees, then I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God is Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on that cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to me, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me, how great thou art, how great.
Have I ever told you how much I love technology? There we go. Well, I woke up this morning and went to turn my little pad on, and the battery was dead, and it said had major update. I love updates. I said, why don't you fix it in the first place? That way you don't ever have to update it. But every time I turn around, I'm updating something. So I've got it on two things just in case the battery does die. I got my phone. So I'm well armed. If you would turn your Bibles to 2 Peter, we're looking in still in chapter 2. We'll be finishing up chapter 2 today. And in 2 Peter chapter 2, let me do a little bit of housekeeping real quick. I just got ahead of myself. We will not be meeting this Thursday. I'll be out of town. So we'll meet the following Thursday. Okay, so now that that's out there, spread the news. Yeah, but now in 2 Peter, this we'll be looking in the verses of. Wait a minute, where'd you go? Oh, have I told you lately? I love, there it is. Technology, there it is. No, still not there. I preached that last time I was here. Where'd you go? Well, I've got the Bible here. I'm just. I do not know what it's doing. No. Well, I'm going to have to get out the phone, it looks like. Here we go. Oh, never mind. Go away. There it is. Okay, stay there. Stay. All right. Somebody does not want me to preach this message is what I'm getting at. All right. So that just fires me up to want to do it even more. Now, our verses today is going to be in verse 10 through 22. We'll be finishing up chapter 2. Now, Peter is going to ramp up his rhetoric concerning false teachers. Now, you're probably asking yourself, what is his fascination with false teachers? Why are we being bombarded continuously with this? Well, I believe that this is probably one of the most important times in our church life. False teaching is running rampant, not only from other denominations or other faiths that we know of, but it's even now within our own camp. Now, we're not, quote unquote, Southern Baptist, okay? However, the Southern Baptist doctrine, their beliefs, their doctrines of faith align with who we are, how we identify ourselves. However, here lately, the Southern Baptists are going off the rails. I'm serious. Those who I used to believe were very solid in their faith are now going far, far left. The convention itself is going left. We have lost one of our seminaries to liberal teaching. The others are beginning to be infiltrated with it. The very thing that people like Criswell and Patterson back in the 60s fought so diligently that we maintain a strong, biblically based faith is now departing. Why is that important? Okay, I'll give you an example, and then you will say, oh, I get that. Now I know where you're going. Friday, I was sitting looking through Facebook, and not only is it springtime, it's time to get out and plant the garden. Guess also what time it is. It is copperhead season. Okay? And here was this big thing that said, copperhead season is here, and this is what you should do. Why is that important? Well, copperheads are just the kind of creature you just don't want to cuddle with. They said, here's how you can tell. Number one, copperheads give birth to live copperheads. They don't lay eggs. They have baby copperheads. So off one day there's one, next day there's probably eight or nine. They say that a copperhead, if it bites you, a lot of times it's called a dry bite. A mature copperhead doesn't want to waste its venom on you. They just want you to get out of their way. However, the little baby copperheads, the cute ones, if you can call a snake cute, will inject you with as much venom as they can. And so they said, here, this is what you pay attention to. If you're out walking around in your wood, your backyard, or whatever, and suddenly you smell cucumber. If you have a strange smell of cucumber coming out from nowhere, guess what? You have now walked into the vicinity of a copperhead. He's already coiled and ready to let you know he is there. Also, a copperhead acts like a rattlesnake. Doesn't have a rattle on its tail, but its tail will quiver. And he also shakes his head. His head rattles, like mine. So, see, he doesn't want to bite you, but if you keep coming, he's going to. One day, when I was young, my grandfather on my mom's side, he was a different individual. He was one of these guys who went out and killed his own food and everything else and just sat around and just ate it there on the open fire. Well, he took me deer hunting one day. He always carried his rifle and his shotgun. And we just left. There wasn't anything out, so we were coming back to the trailer, and he had his rifle on his shoulder carrying his shotgun. And he jumped a covey of quail. Well, instinctively, he just took that shotgun, bam, bam, knocked three of them out of the sky. And they landed over by a cedar tree. And so he's walking in front of me, reloading his shotgun, and never missed a beat. Was walking, took that shotgun, and bam, and just kept on going. Never slowed down, never stopped, went over there, picked up the quail. And then he goes, when you're out here, boy, you have to always be watching. And he reached down, and he picks up about a 4-foot rattlesnake. That was right in his path. I felt sorry for the rattlesnake because it was in his way. So we had rattlesnake and we had quail that night. But just like my grandfather says, you have to be diligent when you're out here. You've got to be on guard. You've got to be watching. Peter is saying the same thing here. He's saying, believers in Christ, pay close attention because there is a danger amongst you. And it's this false teaching. Now, here there's going to be two kind of statements that he makes that are kind of squirrely in the Greek, okay? And interpreters have a difficult time deciding what Peter is talking about. So we're going to touch on both views because they fit. And they fit not only in their teaching in that day, they fit really today. So this is the reason why we need to pay attention. Because it is 2 minutes till midnight. And the virgin church needs to be making sure they have the oil in their lamps and the wicks trimmed and lit. Because the bridegroom is coming. It's 2 minutes till midnight. Now, I'm going to tell you, there's going to be a lot of churches sitting out there not ready. And it's because of what we're going to be talking about today. And I pray, as a matter of fact, I'm kind of confident that we're not in that group. And I'll explain why. But okay, here's first off, we want to know what the dangers of these false teachers are. The first thing we will see here is their depravity. Now, as of the Reformed group, we call it total depravity. Now, it doesn't mean you're as evil as you're going to get, because you can accelerate that. However, our sin has totally severed our relationship with God, okay? And if left unchecked, we are completely separated. Now, these false teachers, don't get me wrong, they're not believers. These are not some people who were Christian 1 minute and then fell away from the faith. As John would say, they went out from among us because they were not one of us. The writer of Hebrews even says, they tasted the enlightenment, but they departed from it. They were never believers to begin with. Okay, so the security of the believer stays intact. You can't lose your salvation. You can't lose what you didn't have to start with. And when we get into the text, the light bulbs are going to go off, and I'm going to tell you, there's going to be an entire television network that you're going to say, oh, Peter's talking about these guys. Okay? Now let's look. First off, their depravity is exposed. We're in the last part of verse 10 and to verse 13. Bold and willful, they do not tremble as they blaspheme the glorious ones. Whereas angels, though greater in might and in power, do not pronounce a blasphemous judgment against them before the Lord. But these, like irrational animals, creatures of instinct, born to be caught and destroyed, blaspheming about matters of which they are ignorant, will also be destroyed in their destruction, suffering wrong as the wage for their wrongdoing. All right, so is that clear as a bell? You're saying, what in the world did he just say? This is one of those weird little statements in Greek that Peter being the great classical Greek writer that he was, right, mentioned. Interesting thing, a little side note, you can impress your friends. The Gospel of Mark is written in some of the worst Greek ever. It's horrible. It's like you go down to Kentucky, you hand somebody something and say, write a thesis. Okay? However, more than likely, John Mark, who wrote the Gospel of Mark, is probably sitting there with Peter, either during one of his sermons or kind of an interview kind of thing, and he's dictating. He's writing this down. So this is where we get the Gospel of Mark. Very horrible Greek. They're street Greek. First and Second Peter are classical Greek. The Greek of the educated. All right. Peter is a fisherman. You think he wrote that? No. He's dictating this to possibly Silas or someone else as they write. And so we get this. First and Second Peter are very hard Greek to study because it's very classical. It's very educated Greek. This statement right here has one of two meanings. Number one, when they're talking about they don't tremble at blaspheming the glorious ones. Who are the glorious ones? Well, they could be either one or two people. Number one, they could be the created beings, angelic beings of God. At all, Satan, fallen angels, things like that. Well, why are they called the glorious ones? Why is Satan called the day star, the bright morning star? Satan was the crown of creation. That's why he was arrogant. That's why he thought he could ascend to the heights in dethroning God himself. His arrogance got the better of him because he was so gloriously created. Well, they're still angelic beings, even though they're demons. Even though Satan is condemned, we do not have the authority to condemn him. Okay, now you're following me. See, isn't this what the text says? Whereas they blaspheme the glorious ones. Whereas angels, though greater in might and power, do not pronounce a blasphemous judgment against them before the Lord. Now, this is a little clear in Jude, and I always want to say chapter 9, but Jude verse 9, Michael the archangel, Jude mentions Michael the archangel contesting with Lucifer over the body of Moses. We don't know what any of that means. However, we do see where Michael doesn't cast a judgment upon Satan. Instead, he says, the Lord rebuke you. Now, who here wants to take on Michael the archangel? Isn't that what that text just said? Even though the angels, who are higher than we are at the moment, when we receive our resurrected bodies, when we pass to the presence of Christ, there is where we will take rank above those who have been created as angels. But as of right now, they're more powerful than we are. You wouldn't take on Michael. Mm-mm. And yet, they don't condemn the fallen angels. They don't condemn the demons. They don't condemn Lucifer himself. Why? They don't have the authority. So when you see a preacher standing up here saying, I bind Satan in the name of Jesus. No, you don't. You don't have that authority. That authority has not been vested in you. Now, I can pray that the Lord rebuke you, Satan. But I don't have that power. Okay. How many of you know of groups of people, of churches, that is their primary function, is naming it in the name of Jesus. I bind you. I curse you. I judge you. No, you don't. You don't have that authority. If the angels won't do it, who thinks we're going to do it? This is arrogance on our part and on theirs. Like I told you, there's an entire religious television station. This is all they do. Is claim things in the name. That's my promise. I claim it. No, you don't. That has not been given to you to do so. Peter just spelled that out. Jude spells that out. Or the glorious ones could be talking about those true apostles who are proclaiming the true gospel of Christ. I lean toward the first one more. However, this one fits too. Because they were taking everything that was being taught beforehand by the apostles and perverting it to their own standard. They were taking the Word of God and twisting it to the point to where they were claiming that Jesus was not coming back. The resurrection already happened. You missed it. He's not coming back. What does the Scripture say? Paul would count numerous times where he would go into a city, proclaim the gospel, get churches started, and walk away. And no sooner than he would leave, in would come the false teachers. Or the Judaizers, which are false teachers in my book. They say, oh yeah, Jesus is great and all, but you have to add this. Or even are saying, like the church in Corinth, that you can reach a certain level of spirituality that is above everything else. No, you can't. That's Gnosticism. However, it is important, if you listen to these people, of how they go against those who stand firm on the biblical account. Those who are biblically based, their foundation is found in the Word of God. For example, now this is where our fellow brethren SBC comes into play. They've been going after an individual, some of the leaders in the SBC, going after one of the prime pastors and biblical teachers today. His name is, let me get it right, Vodi Beckham. He sends chills down my spine when he preaches. I mean, biblical based, firm as a rock. He teaches seminary in Zimbabwe, Africa. So now you get the picture. Well, they're on him because he will not affirm the new social gospel movement, the social justice movement, and critical race theory. Vodi Beckham is an African-American. And he's got a whole book against the teaching of the social justice system and critical race theory. And if he's against it, I'm in his camp. Because if anybody would know what they're talking about, it would be him. However, he's been attacked on all sides for his stance. And now another group is called the Gospel Coalition. They're not the gospel at all. Are attempting to get a movement started to edit or re-edit the Chicago Statement of Biblical Inerrancy. That was written in 1978. This is how young the biblically based evangelical church is. 1978. They got together, all these evangelical leaders, and they affirmed this document called the Chicago Statement of Biblical Inerrancy. And that became the standard of teaching in all the seminaries. That became the standard. Everything that I was taught, and probably everything that Brother Ricky was taught in seminary, was firm, biblically based. You go outside the boundaries of Scripture, you're already out of bounds. You can't come back in and play. However, this group wants to re-examine the document and edit it. Really? What are you going to edit? What are you wanting to take out? If they do that, the evangelical church is in trouble, big time. Because if that's the standard in which we set up our ability to teach, then those who are coming up, who will be given the charge of proclaiming the Word of God, will not be equipped to do so. I had one seminary professor. I think it was my New Testament professor, said, I want you all to write a paper on this certain section of a certain section in the New Testament. And he said, I want you to use four academic resources, and I want you to use one critical resource. I said, this dog ain't gonna hunt. I don't do critical commentaries. I don't do biblical criticism. I don't do textual criticism. I don't do historical criticism. God has given this mandate here. This is the rule in which we follow. If I go about looking through the text and saying, well, this really wasn't written during this time. It was written 200 or 300 years after by one of the early church fathers. Oh, this Jesus really didn't say this. No. I said, I'm not going to use any critical commentaries. He said, well, it's part of the assignment. I said, I'll tell you what. I will use the critical analysis, but then I'm going to attack it. He said, that's what I want you to do. Because I'm going to attack the very thing that they're criticizing by using the Word of God to substantiate and destroy their criticism. I don't know what I got on the paper, but it's okay. We have to be careful. Peter's here saying, you've got to be careful. You look out for these individuals. If this is what their standard is, if they believe that they have the authority that even the angels themselves don't have, we got trouble. If they believe that they can manipulate the authority of the Word of God itself, we've got trouble. And guess what? We have that today. Full force. Not only are they arrogant, They're lustful. Look at verse 13 through 14. They are blots and blemishes, reveling in their deceptions while they feast with you. They have eyes full of adultery, insatiable for sin. They entice unsteady souls. They have hearts trained in greed, accursed children. They have this unbridled lust about them, not necessarily sexual, even though that leads up to it. They believe they're untouchable. It doesn't take but a split second to find an article on a pastor or a seminary professor or a leader of the evangelical movement that has fallen to sexual sin. Doesn't take long at all. It starts with them becoming arrogant. I'm untouchable. I'm a man of God. I'm untouchable. No, you're not. However, this is another one of these weird little sayings. The word deception there could mean deception, but there's another group they're saying. I think what they're saying is he's discussing about how they revile the love feast. The ESV adds a little statement in there. That they revile the love feast. Well, what's the love feast? Well, that's one of the things that got the Christian church in trouble with Rome. Rome thought that Christians were atheists. They didn't believe in the multiple gods. They just held to the one. Well, that's atheism. If you don't believe in the other ones, and you just believe in one. And it said, what do they do at these love feasts? Well, nothing close to what's going on in the emperor's court, but they would tell stories of all the things that were happening during these love feasts. Well, what that was we would call it a fellowship. You bring your fried chicken and your mashed potatoes and gravy. Notice these are things I can't eat, so I'm telling you anyway. They would order mostly from Babes and bring the chicken fried steak and all that other good stuff. Then afterwards, they would partake of the Lord's Supper. It was a fellowship, but it was also a time of worship where they would grow in love for one another while they were fellowshipping. Then they would bring that over into worship as they celebrated the communion. These teachers, these false prophets, these false teachers would go in and completely dishevel the whole thing. Basically, you can see this in Paul's writing to the Corinthians, because this was their issue that they were having too. They'd come in, they'd get drunk. They'd come in, think it was a big party, get drunk, and then the breaking of the bread, the time of worship, would be tainted. These individuals didn't care. And this is what Peter was talking about. They would come into the church and defile the church. Not just necessarily the sacraments or the ordinances, but they would just defile the church, period. That's what's happening today. You have churches all over the place that are moving away from baptism. Yeah, baptism doesn't save you. There's nothing magical about the water. However, it is that statement of faith that a believer makes to the congregation that I have died with Christ. The old me is gone. And the new me, which is not me at all, but is the indwelling power of Christ, the Holy Spirit that is driving me. We've got churches today that have eliminated baptism. They don't do the Lord's Supper. Too old-fashioned. It's not relevant for today. People don't want to go through that. Why? Because if you truly do the Lord's Supper correctly, it's supposed to be a time of self-examination. And if you partake of it with sin, you have partaking of it wrongly. And this is what Peter was writing about. Not only are they lustful, they're controlled by greed. Look at verse 14. They have eyes full of adultery, insatiable for sin. They entice unsteady, so they have hearts trained in greed. Accursed children. They believe that money buys all happiness. And it's their greed for power, their greed for money, their greed for influence that is controlling them. This is their God. Their God is their greed. Now, one person wrote one time, he said, if you go to, I think he mentioned TBN. If you go to TBN's parking lot while they're filming, he said, if you look around, the parking lot is full of just regular cars, old cars. However, if you go to the private parking lot to where all the preachers and stuff are at, you see beautiful, expensive automobiles. What's wrong with this picture? Because they claim, hey, you just send me $1,000 and the Lord's going to bless you 100 times over. Really? How many of you get these Facebook posts that say, if you pray, if you write amen, God is going to give you money. Really? God's going to bless you with money. Unexpected riches is what it says a lot of times. All you got to do is type amen. I'll scroll down there and look at all the amens, and then I put my little post. Tell that to the church in North Korea, and then I'll believe it. They're greed. All they want you to do is give them the money. How many of these pastors have come up and said, oh, the Lord wants me to buy this $10 million jet? Really? What? The $5 million jet I already have is 5 years old. It's time for a new one. I need a $10 million one. Okay, why would the Lord want you with a $10 million jet? Greed. Not only is their depravity exposed, their doctrine is very shallow. Let's look at verses 17 through 19. They are waterless springs and mist driven by a storm. For them, the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved. For speaking loud, boast of folly, they entice by sensual passions of the flesh those who are barely escaping from those who live in error. I get mailers all the time. Come to our church. Come to so-and-so church. We have relevant messages. We have a great orator who speaks power in the name of God. Relevant? What's more relevant than knowing the fact that Christ is coming back and we as His church need to become students of the Scripture? The one thing that just tickles me to death is we're doing Thursday night being holiness in the midst of hostility. I have this book that's kind of the primary go-to book that I've been using. This, we're only doing the Ten Commandments right now. We're learning how to love God and love our neighbor through what is written in the Ten Commandments. And so I've got this book. It's called The Doctrine of the Christian Life. It's about 1,000 pages thick. I think the Remember the Sabbath was like 200 or 300 pages. Kind of covers it pretty well. But what just tickles me pink is we're just doing the 10. I look around and there's people, there's those who come into this Bible study who have this book. This is a theological book that you read in seminary and they've got it sitting there open reading it. I'm going, that's what Peter's talking about here. We need to be deep. I've heard people say, oh, we don't preach doctrines here because doctrines divide. What? What? Doctrines are the deep waters that we as believers dive into. People say that the gospel of Christ is just for lost people. It's not. The gospel of Christ is for the redeemed as well. Each time we hear that our sin has separated us from Christ and that He loved us so much that He gave His life for us should make us hunger for the deeper things. If Christ was willing to die for me, what else? What else does He want for me? That's where doctrines come into play. To where you just dive deep into the deep waters. He says here that they're just waterless springs. They're empty cisterns. You jump down in that well, you're going to land on dry ground. That they're mist driven by a storm. I believe tomorrow, I think we're going to have ourselves one of these good frog chokers. But here he's saying they're just like a cloud just pops up and you go, oh, it's fixed to drench the ground and it just blows off. We need to be deep into the doctrine. They promise enslavement, not freedom. Look at verse 19. They promise for them freedom, but they themselves are slaves. I'll show you the way, the greatness of I am, how you can have your best life now when all they are doing is enslaving you even more because they're slaves themselves. They're slaves to their own falsehood. But then he says their demise is promised. Look at verses 20. For if, after they have escaped the defilements of the world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the last state has become the first for them as than the first. For it would have been better for them never to have known the way of righteousness than after knowing it, turn back from the holy commandment delivered to them. What's the true proverb says has happened to them? The dog returns to its own vomit, and the sow, after washing herself, returns to the wallow in the mire. Dogs and pigs were two of the most unclean animals in the Jewish faith. Dogs and pigs. They were not thought of very highly. And so here Peter says, these people, they're not great teachers. They're not relevant for the day. Guess what they are? They're dogs, they're pigs. And they're going to take you down with them. Now, this was another little section. Is he talking about the false teachers being taken down, or is he talking about those who are following are going to be taken down? I believe it's both. It's a both and. You follow them, they're going to take you down with them. In Christ, in Peter writes here that Peter writes here, he said it would have been better that they have not known. At least they could have said, nobody ever shared the gospel with me. Then to have known just enough to say, yeah, I'm one of those. I'm a Christian. And then go back. Christ would say, if anyone causes one of these little ones, he's not necessarily talking about children either when he says that. He's talking about his children. If anyone leads one of my children to sin, he said it'd be better for him to have a millstone tied around his neck and thrown into the sea than to face me. How many of them in the day of judgment are going to be saying, Lord, Lord, didn't we cast out demons? Didn't we do this? Didn't we do that? And he's going to say, depart from me. I never knew who you were. You can fly that $10 million jet straight to hell. Because that's where you're heading. Because of what you did, not only to my scripture, to my son, but you also did it to my children. And your penalty is far greater. I do believe that we are a very strong Bible-believing church. I believe that God has blessed this church with the hunger for the Word of God. I pray that we maintain that. However, before we leave out of here saying, well, that didn't pertain to me, we know those who are entangled in this. You have friends, you have family, you have co-workers that are in those things that are called false churches, that don't preach the gospel, that don't stand on biblical truths, but have some slick orator, some great music going. Mm-mm. Peter says, this is nothing more than dogs coming back to their vomit, or swine wallowing in the mire after they've been cleaned. It's not about the show. It's about the Savior. And the only way we know about the Savior is in the Word of God. Let us pray. Father God, we do thank you for this day. And Father, as we know that we are drawing ever more closer to the bridegroom coming, we should be just like a young bride getting ready for that day. We should be just giddy over that. Saying, my husband is coming. The bridegroom is coming. And so, Father, I do pray that we here hold deep to your word. But that, as the song said that we sang early, that not only are we to become students of the scripture, we have been told to go out and rescue the perishing, care for the dying, because of the countless number of those that if they were to die today, they wouldn't be in front of Christ, the loving Savior. They would be in front of Christ, the eternal judge. And so, Father, I do pray that if you delay longer the coming of our Lord. That you plant in us this heart, this desire to go out and rescue the perishing and care for the dying. Of course, in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand with me and let's sing Just As I Am.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me.